Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the WLBB Community Voice Program on News Talk 1330 FM 106.3. I'm your host today, Sara Claudia Cain, and I hope everybody is having a wonderful start to your Thursday so far. I'm excited for today's show. I have two guests with me here today, actually. The first one is somebody who you probably recognize, if not by his face, then definitely by his voice. I've got my husband here with me today, Seth Cain. And more importantly, I have my guide dog, Jackson. I'm going to say his name very softly because he's sitting over there with Seth and I don't want him to pop up. But he's here with us today as well. So I'm excited. For those of you who may not know, I'm blind. I lost my sight 6 years ago, and Seth and I met after I had been blind for about 4 years, and we just got married back in May. So he's joining us today to talk about what it's really like to be married to somebody with a disability. So it's going to be interesting. I think a lot of truth are going to come out today.
I think so.
Well, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself a little bit more to our listeners?
Yeah, as you said, I'm Seth Cain. I've been on the radio here in the West Georgia area for 15 years now. I actually got our start at our sister station, WKNG King Country, just when it was AM 1060 back in 2006. And I've been on the radio ever since. And I'm the host of Raising Cain in the Morning on Kiss 102.7 now. I can be heard from 6 to 9. And so if you were kind of flipping stations and you're wondering, how are we hearing you on Kiss and LBB at the same time? It's magic. It's the magic of radio. So I've been doing that. I've been the morning show host on Kiss 102.7 for about since October of 2019. So for going on 2 years. And I'm also the play-by-play announcer, one of the play-by-play announcers for high school football, but I do predominantly Harrelson County Rebel football on WKNG FM 93.7. And other than that, after I get off the radio, I am your husband, and I am Jackson's backup wrangler when you're not around, so or when he's wandering about the house and you're off doing something else. So.
Yep. That's so, about the extent of it.
So that's pretty much the extent of it. Other than that, my life's really not that exciting.
Well, that's not true. But that leads perfectly into how we met, which had a lot to do with what you do for a living. So tell the quick version of how we met.
Yeah, the quick version is that she reached out to me. I was not looking to date at the time, and she reached out to me. I was sitting at the house I was renting at the time in Tallapoosa. My phone lit up, and it was from a Facebook messenger, and I get Facebook messages all the time. I'm in like a couple of different group messages, and so I didn't think that much about it, and I just kind of looked, and I see where it says Tillman at the end of it. I was thinking it was your mom because I've been friends with your mom on Facebook for quite some time, and I was just like, I'll get to that later, and I was like, wait a second, that's a different name that's on there. And it said Sara Claudia Tillman. I'm like, okay. And so I'll open up the message, and you were asking me how to expand social media audience, how to be a speaker, and you're about to start doing the community voice here on WLBB. And you just want to kind of pick my brain about it for a little bit. So we kind of went back and forth for about 3 or 4 days, and then we finally decided, let's meet up for coffee. And so we met on the square at Gallery Row for coffee that night. I remember specifically that night going to meet you when I got into the parking deck right behind Adamson Square. For whatever reason, my heart was about to pound out of my chest and I didn't know why. And I'm like, this is just a business meeting. You're not going for a date. You're not going for anything like that. My watch even said you had a high heart rate for about 10 minutes. And so I didn't know what was going on. I mean, yeah, I was a little bit nervous because I'm thinking, I've really never sat down and had a lengthy conversation with somebody who's blind before. And I didn't want to, you know, say the wrong thing, mess up or anything of that nature. And so that's what made me really nervous. But then after that, we talked for an hour and we left. We went our separate ways and I got back to my house and I hadn't walked in the door, but maybe, I don't know, 2 minutes. And I was thinking, you know, maybe I should text her back, just say, hey, if you ever want to meet up again, talk more, you know, dinner wise, you know, non-dating type thing. But I was like, nah, I'll just wait until the morning. You know, it was late. And you sent me a text message not 2 minutes after I'd walked in the door saying, hey, thanks for meeting up with me. It was great to talk with you. I said, yeah, no problem. I hope we can do this again sometime. And she said, yeah, we can definitely do this sometime over dinner. And but we can talk more than just business. And I'm like, oh, this was an interest meeting tonight, and it wasn't about radio either.
Well, so. It was, but
well, just, not fully, but
you impressed me, and the truth comes out. You weren't just nervous because you were meeting me; you were nervous because of my blindness. So the truth's coming out a little bit.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of that, like, did you have any hesitations when we did start dating because of my disability?
I don't think there was really too many hesitations. I knew in my mind that I knew I was going to, of course, you know, describe stuff to you if we were ever going to watch, you know, a movie or something on TV or things like that. And I think just probably the biggest thing for me was if this does go further than just, you know, the casual, you know, dating thing. How is she going to be able to enjoy stuff? How are we going to be able to do certain things, you know, go to places and experience things and all like that? So I think I had a little bit of hesitation because of all that. But really, I think that was the only thing.
I will say, I love to tell this story on, I think it was one of our very first dates. You brought me a pack of Braille Uno cards.
I did, yes.
Which meant a lot to me. And then on one of our next dates, you asked me to the aquarium, and I think that's a perfect kind of description of how you've approached this from the very beginning, where you kind of take into account how I'm different with the Braille Uno cards, but you also have always treated me like normal, and that's the biggest thing, like inviting me to the aquarium, which was somewhere a lot of people probably would think somebody who's blind wouldn't really enjoy. Yeah. But that's kind of how you've approached this from the very beginning. And that's meant a lot. And that's made me, I think, more comfortable than anything. Yeah. People with disability, they don't want to be treated different all the time. Yes, you have to take it into account, but they also just, we want to be treated like normal people.
Right. And the other thing I tell people too is that, and this is the truth, 90% of the time I do forget that you're blind. Yes. Because you, and you remind me really quickly every day. It's a daily occurrence that she reminds me. But if I were to focus on your blindness 100% of the time, mm-hmm. I would be missing out on the person that you are. Mm-hmm. I would not be focused on your personality. I would not be focused on your kindness, your sweetness, your just all outgoing and independent and strong willed person that you are. I'd be missing all of that. I'd just be focused on your blindness, and that's, I was like, I just can't do that.
Yeah.
And coming from a family on my mother's side of the family, we've got a history with relatives with disabilities. If we go back, way back on my grandfather's side, he had an aunt who went blind at an extremely young age. And then we've had histories with paralysis, amputations, and things of that nature. So being around somebody with a disability was not new to me. Mm-hmm. And when I was around all my other relatives who have different disabilities, whether they were paralyzed or amputees, they were just doing normal things. Now, do they have to do a few things a little bit differently? Well, yeah, of course. But it just, to me, it was like just normal.
Yeah.
Just normal. So
very well said. And we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors, Tanner Health System and Oak Mountain Academy. We'll be right back to hear about some of the misconceptions that come along with our relationship. So stay tuned.
Health is a journey. It's making better choices, even when it's not easy. It's taking care of yourself and the people you love. At Tanner Health System, we're there for you with every step, with primary care, heart care, cancer care, women's care, orthopedics, surgical services, and so much more. We're dedicated to helping you live and feel your best. So let's get on that journey to health. You've got places to be. for many years to come. Find us at tanner.org.
As a graduate of Oak Mountain Academy, I found that my experience on the mountain prepared me beyond all expectations. As a junior at Auburn University, I approached my studies with great confidence thanks to what I learned at OMA. When I think back on my time on the mountain, I think of my teachers. Their genuine love and concern for me as a student was always evident, and now, as an adult, I still foster those relationships. I'm Carly Robinson, an Oak Mountain Academy alum. Visit oakmountain.us to see how you can offer your child an amazing opportunity to be a warrior.
All right, welcome back to the WLBB Community Voice program on News Talk 1330, FM 106.3. Sara Claudia Cain here with our guest, my husband, Seth Cain. And we were just talking before the break a little bit about our early relationship, and Seth mentioned that now, after we've been together for a while, he actually forgets that I'm blind, but I will say it didn't start out that way. One of the very first times he came over to my house, he started trying to guide me around my house. And
yes, I'll admit I did that. I didn't think about it. I didn't think about it. It was something you do every day. So I was, and when you said, no, it's okay, I do this every day. And I'm like, So yeah.
Started out a little too helpful. Now I have to remind him and be like, hey, I need a little help over here.
Sorry, I'm slacking.
No. But let's get into some of those misconceptions about our relationship, because I know you have encountered a lot of them since the time we started dating to when we got engaged and now that we're married. So share some of those.
Yeah, I think some of the misconceptions that people think, and I've had several people ask questions. One of the biggest questions, and this goes hand in hand with the misconceptions, is that, oh, well, it must be hard for you. And I'm like, well, no, not really. I mean, yeah, we have to do things a little bit different. I mean, we can still go to ball games, because, you'll always have your own personal play-by-play guy right there with you. We can still go to movies. If we go to the theater, they have the audio description device. But if we're sitting at home, and which we've done this several times, where we'll turn on, a movie, whether it be on Disney Plus or Netflix or anything else, if it doesn't have audio description, I sit there and I describe it to you. I think one of the first movies we saw, The Santa Claus, because it was around Christmas when we started seeing each other, it didn't have audio description. So I started doing that. So I think that's one of the biggest misconceptions, that just because that somebody is blind, that they can't enjoy a lot of the same things that everybody else can. I was like, yeah, they most definitely can, because you just have to do it in a little bit of a different way. You were talking about when we went to the aquarium, the audio description they had there was not working. So I was having to describe everything to you that was going on. And just like we went across the street to the World of Coke, they even told us that their audio description was messed up. But they said they did something better, and they said, we'll take you on a VIP tour. And, we didn't even have to pay for the VIP experience when we already just had paid for the regular tickets. So I think that's one of the biggest misconceptions, that people who are, whether they're blind or a spinal cord injury, whatever the case may be, cannot enjoy some of the same things that, people who don't have disabilities can. So I think that's one of the biggest misconceptions.
What about that you're my caretaker? I've heard people kind of allude to that.
I have had people come up to me and they'd be like, oh, well, that's so nice that you've taken her in.
Like I'm a stray dog.
And I'm like, she's not a dog, people. She's a human. She just can't see. She can still get around she gets around the house better than I do. She cooks. She even cleans. I remember I walked in the house one day and she was standing in the bathtub in the bathroom, dusting the blinds. And I was like, what are you doing? And she's like, I'm just getting the house cleaned up. I was like, oh, okay, have at it. And so I went on, because I let her just go after it. I mean, she's capable of doing it. And then, she's capable of feeding herself. It's not like I'm having to sit there and spoon feed every meal to her every day. So that's, and as far as the caretaker position, that's one of the biggest misconceptions. She can still do everything that she could before she lost her sight. I think the only thing that she can't do is drive.
Yes, but we're working on that.
Oh, we are. Really are. We'll get there eventually.
Yeah. And I'll say that too. People have said that to me when I got engaged. Like, oh, great. He'll be able to do this, this, and this for you. I'm like, yeah, but I do that myself. Like, yeah, it'll be great to have another set of hands and another set of eyes around the house, but I can do all these things. And I think another thing that I probably get more than you is, oh, he must be such a great guy, you know. And to me, that kind of comes across as, you know, he must be such a great person to want to put up with you type situation.
No, it goes the other way around. She's a great person for putting up with me. That's, yeah. No, I'm kidding, but.
Well, I hear that a lot with other people with disabilities. Mm-hmm. They kind of put their spouse on a pedestal a little bit. And granted, it does take a special kind of person to look past all of that. But like you said before, you can't focus on the disability or you won't see the person.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
I think it more just takes somebody really noticing the person and not the challenges.
Yeah, and the thing is, when you're dating or you're engaged or married to somebody with a disability, there are going to be some same challenges as, you know, a normal, mm-hmm. you know, married couple who can both see or mm-hmm. don't have a disability. You're still going to experience some of the same challenges. But I think at the end of the day, and that's the one word that we both use with each other is patience.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, this, if you really, I guess, want to have, in a sense, you know, your patience tested, in a sense, is when you're, you know, dating or married to somebody with a disability, you know, they're going to experience a lot of challenges that you cannot maybe help with.
Mm-hmm.
And then sometimes they'll get frustrated with you.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you'll get frustrated with each other. But you've got to remember at the day to be patient with one another because, you know, it's still you're both going through it in a sense. With her, she's going through the challenges she can't see. And sometimes I'll forget to describe something or I'll say, hey, that thing is right over there and not say specifically it's right on the counter, right in front of the refrigerator side of the counter, or say that something on the left or something on the right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've made the mistake of doing that. But it's, I think patience has been our biggest word of our whole dating and married life.
Definitely. And again, that goes back to in the core of our relationship, it's normal. Cause that's, mm-hmm. that's what any couple really needs to focus on. And when I do this show, when I host this show once a month, I interview people who have faced challenges in their life. And I told my dad that I was having you on and he said, oh, well, I guess being married to you for 3 months is a big challenge. And of course he was kidding, but as you were saying, being blind comes with its challenges. So mm-hmm. inevitably that's going to pour over into whoever you're around in your relationships. And so we do have, along with the unique misconceptions, unique challenges. And we've already touched on that a little bit, but we will kind of dive more into those after this break. Hear from our sponsors, Tanner Health System and Oak Mountain Academy.
Health is a journey. It's making better choices, even when it's not easy. It's taking care of yourself and the people you love. At Tanner Health System, we're there for you with every step, with primary care, heart care, cancer care, women's care, orthopedics, surgical services, and so much more. We're dedicated to helping you live and feel your best. So let's get on that journey to health. You've got places to be for many years to come. Find us at Tanner.org.
At Oak Mountain Academy, our daily schedule includes convocation, prayer, and the Pledge of Allegiance. By doing so, we build a family-like community where all students grow and flourish and personal faith is encouraged. Through community service and a historical approach to biblical study, our students are taught the value of the warrior way, honesty, respect, and responsibility. Oak Mountain Academy, we are a family creating legacies. To learn more, visit oakmountain.us.
Welcome back to the WLBB Community Voice Program here on News Talk 1330 FM 106.3. Sara Claudia Cain here with my husband, Seth Cain, and we have been talking all of the ins and outs of being married, having a relationship with somebody with a disability. And before the break, we talked a lot about the misconceptions that come along with our relationship. And we started talking a little bit about the challenges. And I will start off by saying, for me, one of the biggest challenges when we got engaged was thinking about you moving in, because everything in my house had to be so organized.
Yes.
Everything in its spot. And I thought, how in the world am I going to make room for somebody else?
Yeah.
So that's ultimately what I started doing. I started cleaning out closets and cleaning out specific drawers. And then when you moved in, I said, okay, this is where your stuff goes. So for me, that was one of the biggest challenges.
Yeah. And it was for me too, because I knew when I was going to be moving from house to house, I was like, oh, I'm going to have to do a lot of downgrading. I'm going to have to throw away a bunch of stuff, which I was already in the works of doing anyway. And I'm thinking, okay, so I'm going to have to put stuff, you know, I'm not going to be able to do like I did in my bachelor pad, as I would call it, and, you know, leave stuff on the floor and or stuff out in the middle of the floor.
Yeah.
And for you to easily trip over and things of that nature. So I knew, okay, this is going to be a bit of a bigger challenge. And then I know I was going to my cleaning, which, yes, I do know how to clean. I know that's a common misconception about me, and contrary to popular belief, I do know how to clean. But I knew that was going to be the one of the biggest challenges for me, is trying to make sure I'm putting stuff to where I know where it is. That's, you know, that's mine. And so our stuff doesn't get put together, you know, clothes especially. You know, clothes are going to be the biggest thing, and having to make sure we had enough closet space, enough drawer space. And so I knew that was going to be a big challenge. And I think just the other challenge too was, you know, here we are, two different people coming in. You know, we got, you know, a lot of the similar personality traits, but we got a lot of different personality traits. Of course, you know, you and I are both very independent people. Mm-hmm. We don't like to ask for help. So sometimes we can clash a little bit when we have to ask for help for stuff. And so I knew that was going to be another challenge that we were going to have to, you know, work through and get past. And it's one of those things. It's not going to be an overnight, you know, thing that's going to be mm-hmm. fixed in a hurry. It's one of those things that you have to work with. And I think that's another challenge, whether you're in a marriage with somebody with a disability or not, you're still going to have that challenge of trying to learn each other over the course of your life, which essentially, you know, we've been doing, and you know, some days we're better at it than others. Mm-hmm. But that's just part of it.
Yeah. And I will say that that's something that I've heard a lot from people with disabilities, is they don't like to ask for help, and they don't like people to all of a sudden swoop in mm-hmm. and offer help in a way that shows they think you can't do it
exactly.
yourself. And I think that was something we had to learn too. You know, mm-hmm. when you saw me struggling, not all of a sudden coming and trying to help, because you knew eventually I would get it. And if I didn't, I would ask for help.
Yeah.
So I think that was probably a big challenge that you had to kind of get over in your own head.
It was, because if I see somebody, you know, that I know that needs help, I'll try to help them. You know, I've always been that way. But it's like a lot of times I'll be sitting in the back room watching TV and you'll be just kind of milling about the kitchen or something. I'll hear you either drop something or run into something. The next thing you're here, I'm okay. I'm okay. I'm okay. And I'm like, you sure? And you're like, yep, I'm good. I'm like, okay. So I'll go back and watch TV. And I was like, well, if you need any help, you know, just holler at me. She's like, I've got it. And I'm like, okay. And then sometime later you'll be like, I need help. And so I'll get up and I'll come in and help you. But yeah, but other than that, you're pretty independent. So just, like you said, if we can just get you to start driving, that
yes.
we're joking around about yes. that, but yeah. But, other than that, that's, yeah, I think that's one of the biggest challenges that we face, is just being independent and hate asking for help.
Yeah. And back to the cleaning, I will say that mm-hmm. you've done a great job. I just had to leave for 3 weeks to go get my guide dog. And I was a little worried, I'll say, about the house, the state of things when I returned. But it was spotless.
Thank you.
So kudos to you.
Appreciate it.
And I know we've talked a lot about the trials and the challenges and the misconceptions and all the negative things, but like any relationship, we have our trials, but we also have our triumphs and we've had a lot of laughs along the way.
Oh, yeah.
So is there one story that's like your favorite story, whether it has to do with blindness or disability or just funny relationship things that you would like to share?
I think it would have to be one of our most recent excursions back in July. So we decided to head up to Rome. And for those of you who don't know, she was at Berea College in Rome when everything happened, when she lost her sight. But before then, she was all the time just going about campus. And there was this one place that she loved to go to. It was called the House of Dreams, which was Martha Berry's kind of vacation home. And it was there on top of Lavender Mountain. She said, talked about it. And she said, yeah, we used to go up there all the time. And it's a really nice place. You can see forever up there. I said, okay, we'll go up there one weekend. I think it was July 5th. We had the Monday off. We get up there and we go find the parking spot at the Watermill. And so I download this app that some friends of ours told us about. It's an All Trails app. And I was trying to find the map on how to get up to the mountain. Well, we couldn't find the actual trail. So I'm like, okay. And me thinking, I'm like, well, maybe we can find a shortcut that'll kind of short the way. So I look on the map and I look at the phone. I'm like, okay, here's the little dotted line and it's sending us up. So I look up. And I'm like, okay, this hill's not that bad. So we get up there and we finally flatten out at one spot. And of course, if you're seeing me on camera right now, you know I don't miss a meal. I'm out of breath. I'm not as in shape as I was this time last year. And I'm about to pass out. And I'm trying to stay strong for her. And she's like, we can go back. I'm like, nope, we made it this far. We can keep going. So we finally go up a little bit more. I'm still having to slow down and stop taking breaths along the way. And then she's like, don't die on me because I would be out of, you know, luck. We finally get to a road. It's flattened out. So I'm looking at the map. I'm like, let's try going left. We go left, take us way off the trail. I said, let's go back right. Still taking us off the trail. So I finally find the trail that we're supposed to be going on that's taking us up the mountain. And I started looking further up and my neck almost broke as it's going as high as it can. I was like, oh, you've got to be kidding me. I'm like, nope. She wants to go see this house. We're going to go see this house. And so the more we got up there, I was still having to slow down. And if you've seen pictures of her, she is small. She is not big by any stretch of the imagination. She was having to push me up this mountain. All 255 pounds of me. And I'm thinking, please, Lord, do not let me fall on top of her because that is either going to really damage her or kill her possibly. And I would hate to have to tell that in the news story. So we finally get up. We get to this open area and you can see forever. And I'm like, surely to God, we have got to be closer. And so there's this hill. I mean, it's looking like it's going literally straight up at a very tall angle. And I was like, nope, we're going there. And then we finally get to the top. There's the House of Dreams. And I'm down on the ground. I'm kissing the ground by this time. But she was literally having to push me up. And if you can just imagine her having to push my big backside up this mountain, it was a sight to see. And she's all the time saying, don't die on me.
We made it, though. We did. It was worth it. And on the way back, we found the nice, easy trail winding down that we should have taken up.
But yeah, we eventually found
that trail. That's just another story in our relationship. But thank you, Seth, so much for coming on. And thank you for giving the advice just to look at the person.
National headlines and the local stories you care about. WLBB, Carrollton, News Talk, 1330.